Hello YouTube, me again, with another boring video. This one is actually a request from a number of people who have asked for more advice and hints and tips on writing. Well, me being me, I've already put a chunk of this sort of information on the internet for you. It's just a matter of knowing where it was. This is my writing website. There's the URL for you. To keep your own website as an author is a decision that you're going to have to make. It is the case at the moment where, well, what do you say? A lot of people are publicizing themselves and have their followers on services such as Twitter. There's my page there. Facebook, all the rest of that jazz. But we live in days where social media, which is funded majority by advertising, is not maybe the best idea, to put it mildly. It's, you never know what's going to happen to your account. It's only going to take somebody who doesn't like you, and there are plenty of those. Once you become an author who starts to get known, you will have your enemies who will hate you just for the simple fact that you exist, if nothing else, and they will come after you. As a result, if you've got things on social media, they could find things to report you for and then get your account terminated. And before you know it, you've lost all your followers and you've lost a critical link with your readership. So that's one thing to keep in mind and is another reason to keep your own website. If you're clever about it, you can generate a website which is relatively straightforward to keep control of and easy to code, and you know, hosting shouldn't cost you a small fortune, so it's worth it. I have investigated some things like mailing services, and if I ever do start to gather a following that's makes it worthwhile for the expense, then yes, I'll do it. But at the moment, just a simple, relatively static page like this is more than enough. As you can see, I've only got 6 books out there at the moment. 6 current books, that is. I've got links to my current social media, so people can follow me there if they like. The homepage has the most up-to-date news, but for other people, under the extras, I actually have a news history, and that goes back to January 2005. So if you want to see what I was up to, including my spell at WinterCon, that's there as well. So keeping a homepage with some relatively uncluttered links and simple information is, you know, a must. So somebody drops in and they can instantly see when the news was updated, so they can determine, oh, actually I've already read that, don't need to, and cut back later. I've tried to inject some humour in what I've been writing, you know, to sort of make it interesting for people. We'll come to the bulk of this, which is the hints and tips, in a bit. The books, as you can see, nice straightforward list. It's kept as minimal graphics, just to make loading time faster. And each book typically has a description. In some cases, the cover art has also been publicized. An excerpt, buying links, and ISBN. As you can see, I've put the Fiction for All and the paperback site in bold. If people want to buy from Amazon, I've got the link there. If you hunt things down on other services, you will find it simply by the ISBN number. But for reasons that I explained in other videos, if you happen to be with a publisher, then typically you should get a better return than self-publishing on Amazon. There is really no other way of getting into this other than practicing your writing, becoming better at it, until you can go to a publisher and, you know, with work which they are happy to represent, is the long story short. You do have to be very careful with the publishers. Read the terms and conditions. In some cases, some people have wound up surrendering their rights to the publisher over the works, and it's got very nasty when, at the end of the day, sometimes the publisher hasn't delivered for them and they want to move somewhere else. They've wound up tied in with that publisher. So you really need to examine your terms and conditions very, very closely. Some cases I've had permission from reviewers to republish their reviews. This is a 4-star out of 5. You know, not a glowing report because I'm not that good a writer yet, you know. But it gets difficult. You've got to watch what you're doing, because J.B. Garner, he's himself an author. I've reviewed some of his books. I've paid for them. Full disclosure always helps, you know. Honesty is a big, big value. You know, nothing turns people off than finding someone who's dishonest. So full disclosure usually helps. And I've paid for the books that I've, of Garner's books that I've read, you know. So I haven't got any freebies from that, you know. Making that kind of point helps. So for each book, you can see pretty much what's gone on. Parental notes, mild swearing and some violence. I found it important to put the parental notes in these days. One of the reasons for that is because of the time I spent at Wintercon, you know, on a table selling books. And some young, well, not young children, you know, kids who were old enough to be able to put up with a bit of swearing, as there was, and violence, as there is in all the media these days. But, you know, okay, the kid was there with his father, and they came to the decision. But it bothered me that I hadn't specifically put across the information of what the book contained in terms of parental note. So it wasn't that the parent and the child made any form of complaint. This was an observation that I made myself for my own peace of mind, you know, so that people who are buying the books have an idea of what's in them. So that was something else that I came out of that with. I'm not sure that I actually have that hint on here. I think it is on one of the other sites. If you go to the book likes, and I think if you do a search, book likes is not the fastest responding of sites, especially when they're potentially in maintenance. And type Wintercon in. Hopefully that will take you to the posts. The first convention, there you go. So it is done. I'm now at home, sat at a keyboard, and the advice that the lessons I learned basically from going to Wintercon, and things I would do again, I wouldn't do again, you know, all the bits and pieces. One, age. Top of the list is the age of the intended buyer reader. Selling on the internet, we're shielded to a degree in order to purchase, credit card, yada yada, but at a convention there's no such check. So think about the content, in particular F-bombs, other language things, and yeah, it doesn't help that there is no guidance around for books like there is for films. There doesn't seem to be any guidance body, which is a real pain. It's a long-running issue. You know, it's an oft talked about issue which hasn't been resolved really. Eye level signing. Some people have got roller displays that cost a fortune. On the cheap, you can get away with an A1 easel. That kind of signing leaves the desk, the table that you've hired, free. Eye level is important to make contact with people, and be careful about your wording. What I found was a lot of my signs were literally on the table, and were also taking up presentation room, because when you buy a table, you rent a table, you know, it's not a lot of space when you come down to it. Standing up and smiling. You know, if you're sat behind the table and people are walking around, you're at the wrong level to make contact with them and smile, you know, invite them to say, put out a signal that you're welcome and easy to start a conversation with. You're going to have to be prepared to make a loss. I mean, there were a number of people there with solid fan bases, and they were running long books at about £5, well below the main price. I had to cut price drastically just to compete, and it looks like the established authors use events to make contact with their fans rather than make a profit off the books. So they will drop their prices as a favour to their fans, and that's got a knock on to other authors. Don't count on the organiser for all the information. Think in advance of the kind of people's ages that are going to be present, and even if the organiser says that certain things are okay, like the organiser did say with my adult books, you know, common sense should have told me, nah. You know, merchandise is a difficult one. Some traders were saying that their sales didn't pick up until they actually started to have supporting merchandise on the tables. Hulking that around plus extra time setting up and clearing down has its additional stresses, something to think on depending on bits and pieces. The important thing was, if you have an artist license for any cover art, you might need another license in order to use that artwork on merchandise, so be careful when you're getting artwork licensing sorted for your books. Talking points. I mean, one of the authors had a crow balloon there in order to start off conversation, to get people to ask her, oh, what's this then? Why have you got that on the table? That sort of thing. Business cards, bookmarks, whether you offer those for free because they've got your details on them, you know, different experiences. There's more there. I've shown you how to find that. Maybe worth more of a read. So, we have three sections here: behind the scenes, manuscripts, and some extras. The extras has the author bio, simple, straightforward. There's an FAQ of various things that I've been asked. I won't actually scroll this down because there's a number of pictures and other things Some of the questions, how did I research the subject for my books? And obviously, with the BDSM side, are the numbers of people in the scene real? Because I did put numbers and references in the books, which are based off research and all the rest of that jazz. And there's other questions which people have asked, which I've put in there. So that gets that out of the way. I've shown you the news history all before. So let's come to the meat of this. The behind the scenes has still to come. I found it as a useful dumping ground for the things that are in my mind, places where I want to go. The White Wizard, fiction, Tolkien-esque, that sets the mood. I've already got some more on that written, which I'll show you. The MacGuffin, present-day comedy. Smith, which is a fiction, present-day, which was actually a follow-on from Amar's General Hooper and Checkmate. So it's a follow-on from that. One of the things that I found myself doing is wondering about things, pondering, and what would happen, you know, off the back of all the discussions that we've had on YouTube, is what would the world look like if suddenly the atheists had their way and there was an argument presented which blew all theism out of the water? What would the world look like? So that's one. The Day Religion Died. Again, fiction, present day. Finally, it happened. The day that every religion dreaded, and science proved beyond all doubt that deities couldn't exist. A statement of undeniable fact started circulating, and once anyone read it, the logic of the argument tore any belief in any god or an afterlife right out of their very soul. Within a few days, the face of the planet changed forever. Places of worship were abandoned. Prayer mats floated on the wind. Consecrated wine was left to sour, and the global population had to find a new way. With empty hearts, the people of the planet searched as one, once more, for the meaning of life. This time, however, everyone knew that it wasn't 42. A Democracy of Three, fiction, present day. Long story short, army, aircraft, pilots. There's been a bit of a split, and a coalition of three take over the country. And this is one that I want to start, that I've been requested to start, but research has drawn a bit of a blank, in particular because it involves helicopter fighting. What I've got to work out is what happens to the body during helicopter flight, you know, during battles, and you know, the g-forces, the effects, how things feel. That's what I've had problems finding. But yeah, that's high on the list. AAI, sci-fi, present day. The cycle began. An apple and a cream cake on a plinth. Measurements were taken and a computer algorithm made his decision. Up on a screen were popped the word apple, beneath a continuous stream of apple. The researchers pondered the human element, the thing that allowed someone to look at the apple and the cake, and even after deciding that the apple was the better option, to nevertheless reach out and take the cake. What would it take, they pondered, to make the machine choose the cake? Comedy, The World Is Mine. Throughout the ages, the human race has had its megalomaniacs, struggling to take over the world. Knights were dispatched against errant squires, and the likes of James Bond were sent to say Niet to Dr. No. But it was inevitable that, throughout all these battles, one of these supervillains would eventually succeed. Finally, physicists would get an answer to the question of just how much pressure a supervillain could actually take. Another one of thoughts is reversed. Today, 0.6% of people are totally blind, you know. 1 in 200 people are blind. That's an awful lot of people. But, you know, we evolve. And I was wondering of what would happen by the year 2400 if the ratio had flipped and 99.4% of the population were now blind at birth, and with only 0.6% of the human race now sighted. Life for them, where the majority were blind, would be very different to the life we know today. So these are some of the ideas and the things I've put down, and it does help because some of these are now 2 years old, as we'll come to. To the chunk of it, I have writing advice. Let's just zoom in on some of this stuff. And I've got other people involved. Companion, the first of the new books, went to about 10 people, and different people came back with different advice. The things that worked and didn't work for them, and in some cases, it was contradictory. Writer's block, walk away. There's nothing so demoralizing as continuing to bash your head against a brick wall. I mean, I've personally have found that if writer's block has happened, just walk away from it. There's also some advice on language level. I mean, some people really have strong dictions, but in order for the work to flow, I mean, as I said here, I've tried to read stuff by Stephen Fry, and because I've had to reach for the dictionary so often, it's just turned me off what I was reading. You know, that's one thing. You know, it's got to flow. It's got to flow. Editing. You've got to keep at it. I mean, later on in another page, I've shown you some of the things that I look for and specifically go through a book for, because I know that they're the common mistakes that I make. I try and get this done before it goes to somebody to who will edit it properly, you know. The cheaper editors out there are cheap for a reason, you know. Some of them are good editors, they're just getting started. But others, you know, they do not do a good job. They're cheap for a reason. Chicken and egg situation, you've got to be making money before you can afford a decent editor. And, you know, you've got to have a decent editor to make the book decent to make the money in the first place. You can't win. Review with different devices. Sorry about that sudden jump there. I found that when I look on things on paper, on screen, or on an e-reader, I will pick up different faults, different flaws in what I've written. You know, sometimes typos will shine through. I couldn't tell you why, it just works for me, it's something to try. Deadlines are an important one. I mean, a lot of stuff will get written and it'll never be published. But if you really want to be serious, you've got to have some form of structure. I mean, okay, if writing is not the main focus of what you're doing, you're going to have to give yourself some leeway because life will get in the way. Your day-to-day job will get in the way. But you do need to have some form of structure if you're actually going to be serious. Otherwise, deadlines will just keep slipping. It's okay to let them slip now and then, but you know, you got to have something to help keep you on track. Descriptive practice. You know, just keep rewriting things, you know, and you'll get stuff down just for the sake of doing it. In the case, I just wrote about Rolls-Royce engine, gunship, and all the rest of that jazz. And after I was writing it down, after I'd got what I wanted to do, the action, the emotion, then I could go around tuning it. I mean, initially, my original gunship in this was 20 tons, before some cursory research found out that the Apache only weighs a little over 5. And there was actually a version of the Apache helicopter with the Rolls-Royce engine that was specifically made for Britain. So I do have some leeway there. But, you know, keep writing things, even if it's only a couple of paragraphs. You know, write it, get a bit of practice and work on it. And more on that in another section. Readers aren't idiots. I was talking with one of my colleagues about 50 Shades, which was all the rage at the time, and she said that, yeah, she read parts of it and thought, yeah, right. You've got to make things realistic. Even if they're fiction, they've got to be believable. People can jump the most awesome of caverns in their imagination if you give them a clear definition of the other side and the desire to get there. People have got to keep relating to the story and being able to have that emotional connection. You know, keep it real is an aff saying, but it's the closest I can get. easy to grasp characters. This is awkward. I mean, as I said in the first paragraph here, I picked up one ebook and the first chapter introduced so many different characters and asked me to get to grips with them. Whoa, this is too much information, and I just put it down and never picked it back up again. You know, try and introduce a few characters at a time and make them memorable. If you make them memorable, then in a different section of the book, it only takes a small part of their personality to click and the character comes back. The name sometimes is not enough. Some people can grip a character so well that if I introduced Ethel as a smoker in chapter 1 and then made a reference in chapter 30 to some mysterious character having been hidden behind a curtain and there was a cigarette butt on the floor, some people will immediately know that it was Ethel and make that connection, but not all readers are like that. So you've got to have that sort of thing. Good characters, make them memorable, and when you bring a character back or reference a character, as well as referencing the name, just try and reference something about that character that will bring them back, you know, something about their personality which will help the reader to recall which character it is. Chapterization is a difficult one. It's one of those things that you can't win, you can't lose. Different people, different preferences. I put chapters when there's going to be a serious change in the story. I think if it smooths something out and a delineation is needed to help improve the flow, then I will put that chapter in. I will put that break in. Don't rely on Oaken knowledge. My example here was an overriding one. I tried to read Zombie Fallout by Mark Tufo. I read the first one, but I didn't want to read the rest of it. For the first 20% of the book, you know, there was a fog, because it was relying on loads of quickfire American humor and references, and I could not follow it. Net result, I didn't give up on that book, but I gave up on the series, you know. And like I said, in Companion, as the scene is set at Brighton Pier, some of my readers haven't been to Brighton, but they'll know what a pier is, as long as I mention a seaside and a few of the references, you know, things should, you know, lay the breadcrumbs. Don't avoid the awkward. This, I think, is an important one, specifically because a lot of people are driven, you know, drawn into stories for the drama. If you have a patch between characters that's difficult, emotionally difficult, you know, take the reader into that, you know. If you avoid it and just brush over it and said, yeah, such and such had an argument and next day they woke up, you know, you've missed some of the meat that the readers want, you know. So don't avoid the awkward. Sometimes I've used humor. Life is a bit of everything. So are stories. So yeah, sometimes a little bit of unexpected gem or twist or turn helps. It breaks it up and stops it just being a monotone. I was using multiple devices and working on three different books at this time. I was actually working on four, and I was working on different devices. Sometimes leaving copies behind on devices acts as a bit of a backup, and what I have was these, which are coloured post-it notes with the title of the manuscript, and wherever that post-it rested, that device had the current version. Not ideal, but there you go. So there was White Wizard that I was working on. I was also working on From the Cradle and To the Grave. Those two are published. That one is maybe the next one, I don't know. But that was one way of working, because backing up the manuscript is important. And if you're jumping devices, you know, leaving the copies behind was an easy but messy form of backup. Yeah. That's just an idea that may or may not work for you. Punctuation. Heavily reliant on spell checkers. Punctuation requires a lot of effort. I'll go into that in a bit more detail in the next one, because I had to actually expand that, because it was one of the things that some reviewers were bashing me over the head for. Now to the most difficult. Publicity and getting the work reviewed. Where do I start? Every minute, a book is being published in the UK and the US. You know, there's a lot of books out there. Trying to publicize anything is difficult because, you know, the minute you say something, people know, well, that's the author. Of course they're going to say such and such, and your words won't carry any weight. But also trying to get your work reviewed, that's another nightmare. Ideally, if a book gains traction and people do start reviewing it, you know, one in every 100, if you're lucky, will leave a review purely because they like to leave reviews. But otherwise, you know, reviewing services that you pay for are a double-edged sword, because if you've paid for a review, then people have the view, oh, well, yeah, such and such review is obviously going to be good because the author's paid for it. But finding someone who is an enthusiastic and skilled reviewer, obviously, read their reviews to find out just how good a reviewer they are, because there are a fair number of amateur reviewers who can't review properly, you know, because they're new at it or whatever, or nobody has been able to mentor them in reviewing, so they're pretty much doing it off the cuff. You know, it is very difficult, you know. You've pretty much got to put forward your book for review with various, try and find a reviewer who likes to review the kind of thing that you've written. I did have real problems trying to get the Submissive Heart series reviewed, because by that time 50 Shades had actually done a lot of damage. The quality of the writing, my particular problem with that series is it straddles. It's aimed at the vanilla rather than the BDSM audience. So although BDSM reviewers, yeah, they'd have no problems with it, getting a vanilla reviewer to review it, because it's a series that's meant to bridge a gap, was very difficult. It's not easy, what can I say? Pretty much the only thing that I can put forward is to be part of the community. I'm on Book Likes, I read books, I review them. Some people tend to have, you know, they've drawn a hard line. They said, if you're an author, then you're not entitled to review books. I mean, what are you doing reviewing books, you know? Where's your authority? Because you're on the other side here, you know? You're the enemy, you know, sort of thing. It gets very, very messy. But I think honesty is the best policy, and keeping up an honest image. And, you know, it's the only way to build up your reputation as a person, I think. Sometimes when everyone is walking north, the way to get noticed is to strike up a path to the south. Good luck is all I can say on that one. Punctuation. You can go bananas on this. There are typically two ways of doing it. In terms of the commas, which is where the commas come before. Here we go. The basics of this very complicated situation is usually by considering outside, like this, as being the British style, and inside being American. Outside, oh, here we go. Punctuation inside the quote or outside, and commas and other things inside or outside as well. So I did a bit of research. One of the reviewers said above all the important thing for her was that someone is consistent rather than mix it up. So I went through a few books, and here we have Tom Brown's School Days, which was published in 1857. The author was a lawyer and a judge, and what do you say? Sometimes he had it outside, sometimes he had it inside. There's another in, there's another out, you know. All over the place. Douglas Adams is a British writer, a British author, published in Britain primarily, and his style was inside. You clearly see the American style in constant use. But there's something else. Note the quotations. They're single quote as opposed to double. So immediately he's used single rather than double quotes for speech, and he's using the American inner view. Okay. So we come up a bit more modern than Terry Pratchett's Feet of Clay. Again, another British author, British publisher. Again, he's using the American inner section, and again he's using single quotes for speech. And not only that, but with speech that's within a speech, he's got double quotes. Okay. Goodbye, Mommy. Now, she's an American who moved to the UK, wrote the book while in the UK. Actually, she lives about a handful of miles from where I am, but yeah. Again, she's used single quotes for speech, and things are inside. So we go to the other Michelle Knight, and her book, Finding Me. Now, she's an American author, most likely edited by American editors and published in America. Note that she's using double quotes for speech, and we've got the inside technique here. Yeah. So, which is right, which is wrong? I don't think that you can actually tell any particular right from wrong. Oh, excuse me. The important thing is just to keep it consistent. I do think that from a number of years, and the number of prominent British authors, I think that the old British way of the external quote or punctuation is pretty much dead by the looks of it, and pretty much everything seems to have gone American. I do know that for my publisher, he stipulates that my speech is in double quotes, and if I'm quoting someone's thought process, then the thought is in single quotes, and that's my publisher's stipulation, so that's what I try and meet myself. Now we come up to the various bits and pieces of equipment. The home office, various odds and sods. You've seen these, that I have a very inspirational view of the communal car park, and keyboard is at an adjusted height, monitors are at the adjusted right height, the top of the monitors are with my eye level. The mouse is a bit off, but there you go. But yeah, I also have a wrist rest beneath the keyboard, as you've probably seen on previous videos, and you can see some of the other devices there. I go through the mice. Actually, I'm not actually running a G400 anymore. I've got to update that. The Stream netbook that I had before the AirBook. It light, thin. It had more than enough power to do like 7 or 8 hours writing on it. Ultimately, it was a piece of crap. But there you go. I do find that having a reasonable power netbook with me at all times is handy, because I never know where I'm going to be or where I'm going to get a chance to write stuff. And also, the netbook has supported me in various other things that I do, you know, like if I need to dump some content or copy something. There's not a lot of storage on board these, but to be able to have this kind of processing power is with me at all times is definitely a bonus. E-readers. I've got two. My regular driver is the Kobo H2O. It's weatherproof to a certain degree, and indeed it's waterproof. Sorry about that. It's waterproof, and it's backlit. My first one, it was actually a gift. It was a Kindle, original Kindle, not backlit. But I do find that if I read a manuscript on each of these, I will pick up different mistakes. It's back to the old thing of viewing something on a different device. I started taking notes on the Yola, on the mobile phone that I had with me at the time. Typically, if something's small and it's not worth firing up the netbook for, I needed somewhere to take it down. Later, thanks to EEPROM and the EEPROM 9, wound up with the voice recorder for use in the car. It's relatively straightforward, easy to start, easy to stop, doesn't really grab any attention because the buttons, simple. And I do have the desire for what I love in a machine, in the ultimate writing netbook. Dyslexic writing. I've always said that mild dyslexia plus a 70 word per minute typist equals alphabet soup. Some of my common mistakes are whomever and whoever. There is a difference. They are interchangeable. I often get your and your mixed up. One's a contraction of you are, the other is possessive. Whose and basically means of somebody. Whereas whose is a short form of who is. You lose a race and loose off around. Has and had. I do get my tenses mixed up and it's very awkward. So I have to keep watching that. Into and into. One is in order to. I'm going into the pub in order to have a drink. Obviously check for swearings, and checking up for mixing character names. I tend not to, but there was one where somebody helped me out and I gave them the honour of naming two of the characters. And one of the characters was, that they named was close to one of the characters that was already in the manuscript. So that confused me. And checking the number of ums. One of the things I do is just too many ums in speech. The White Wizard. I started this at the start of 2015. Earlier on, I documented the process of writing a Futurama fan fiction. We'll get to that. And this follows the process of the starting of The White Wizard. How's it going? Unremarkable. All the decisions that I made, some of the things that I was thinking about, coming up with names. And one of the things that I eventually did was a brain dump. I actually worked out, the main character is female. So one of the things that I had to do was work out whether wizard could refer to a female. It can. Person of extraordinary powers, genius, magician. That was what the dictionary said. So it didn't specifically say male. Witch, it does. A witch is a woman. Sorcery, witchcraft. A mage is a magician. So ironically enough, the only serious common word which actually a tribe or was attributed to a specific gender was witch. Brilliant. Also bits and pieces, and this was the mind dump of chapter one. I knew where I wanted to go and this was it. This is the mind dump as I dumped it. Bits in bold as to where I took a break, things that were happening. So then you have the complete first dump. Then I worked on translating things and modifying them. Other bits and pieces, made more decisions, first or third person. what genre, you know, then I polished it up a bit, and there's the polished chapter. Meet Your Maker. Back in about 2006, I wrote a fan fiction for a Futurama episode, and again, I wrote down various posts on the blog as to where my thoughts were going and the research that I did in order to create it, and how I worked out how to bring cows back into the world and make the whole, you know, what bovine infections, and go all through various bits and pieces and merge it all with the Futurama fan universe. Not fan universe, the universe. Some of these links don't exist anymore, but yeah. What I used, which is Celtics, to create the script. History, creativity. I actually had to I'd seen all of them. You know, I've seen all of the episodes, but I had to go back to do specific research, and other sites were very good for working some of that out, to work out what I was going to do, and for checking on my accuracy, my honesty to the Futurama universe. So I had to do all that. Then you've got The Story of Elle, which is the Submissive Heart series, and what each of the books was about, and the specific thing and the points that it was making, and how I started writing it as a film script in 2005, where we went, how we registered it. Registered the script, put it forward, and how all that happened. So that's behind the scenes. Manuscripts. Now, this is The White Wizard, which is still a work in progress, and you have the first two chapters there. That hasn't been worked on for quite some time, but you have that there. Doctor Who, The Aftermath. this is a short that I came out with. You know, things will just strike you, and, you know, run with them. Even though they're only going to be short, just get the practice in. External, care home. Jane is walking off the street, through the gate and up the path. She's aware of the documentary camera crew following her. Jane is distressed about the whole situation.
I mean, it's okay for the doctor. He swoops in, saves the world, and then buggers off again. Not so much as a by your leave.
She reaches the door, pushes the buzzer, and announces herself. There's a buzzing sound. Jane opens and walks through the door. The crew follows.
Hi, Flo.
Hi, Jane. She's in the usual chair.
Thanks.
Jane walks further into the building, documentary crew following. Jane talking over to the documentary crew over her shoulder.
I mean, he just leaves us to cope with all the mess. This happened after the cyber invasion in 2011. I mean, look at Granny there.
They emerge into a room full of chairs and elderly people. A Cyberman is sat in a reinforced chair holding knitting needles.
Our surgeons can't cope with this advanced technology. No one can get her out. She's stuck in there.
Identify.
It's Jane, Granny.
Searching database.
We think dementia's setting in. It takes longer each time for her to look me up.
Identified. Would you like a nice cup of tea?
No thanks, Gran. We're not stopping long.
Granny Eve returns to her knitting.
Whatever she says, don't accept her offer of tea and biscuits. Every time she tries to eat a jammy dodger, we've got to get the local body shop to buff her face up again. I mean, they've been very accommodating so far, but you can tell they feel very awkward about it.
Jane pauses while she looks at Granny for a while, then returns to talking at the camera.
We daren't plug her into the mains. For a start, the neighbours complain about the voltage drop, but then she goes through wool at 5 balls a minute. Have you tried finding that kind of knitting habit? I mean, it wouldn't be so bad, but no one wants to buy woolly jumpers at cyber size. Not that now that we're fighting obesity. Where the heck she got the pattern from, we don't know. I mean, if the doctor could at least help us reprogram her with a pattern that would sell, I mean, that would be a start. She looks to Granny for a few more moments and then turns to the camera again. I really don't know what we're going to do. I mean, funding her care is a nightmare. She's guaranteed rust-free for 500 years. How do you think we're going to cope with those sorts of bills? I dread to think how we're going to cremate her. The local steel factory went out of business years ago, and they were the only place for miles around with crucibles hot enough to melt her. Fortunately, that's one problem that's a few generations down the line. The only upside to all this is that young Jimmy can still sit on her knee when he's 50. I mean, where the heck is the doctor in all this, eh? I had another idea, which was when a Welshman becomes cultural ambassador to the Silurians. Well, being underground isn't too much of a problem. I'm from a mining family, see, so I suppose it's in the blood. I'm Welsh, so I can use that accent. It's my original one-ish. But the Silurians, in case you're not a Doctor Who fan, they normally spend their time underground. Yeah. You have The Making of Robo Christmas, which is the actual fan fiction that came out of all that stuff, be it the behind the scenes. That was Meet Your Maker. Okay, well, let's do the other one. Yeah, The Making of Robo Christmas is the first one, 2006. Futurama kills 99% of all known myths dead. And you actually have a large script. You just got to try and remember the various characters. Fan fiction like this never gets made. It's one of the downsides of the litigation society that we live in these days, that script crews have to be kept separate from all these things in case somebody claims, oh, you got that idea from my fan script I sent for you to review. You owe me money, you know, and all that basically killed off anybody being able to get any ideas into the team and to actually open up things more to the community and for fans to have some sort of input. You know, it's driven a massive wedge between show writers and the fan base, really, which is a real shame. But there you go. So I can put this stuff up knowing that it will never actually be made into an episode. And you have the one that followed it, which was Meet Your Maker in 2009. This was the other long one. What did I do? Meet Your Maker was the one that I actually put down the description of. The Making of Robo Christmas wasn't really... it was Meet Your Maker which was described. Other than that, you've got Fun Time. Now, this is one of my short stories, which was published in 1995 in SM Illustrated Stories, Issue 1. You're probably not going to be able to get that these days. But, it's not too hot, but it's a nice little short that goes on for a while. You've also got a two voice. Now, I was at a literary festival in 2013, and the people, Liars League, was on the stage talking, and they threw down a gauntlet. They threw down a challenge. So, what Liars League does is... they take scripts and they have people in coffee shops read them and act them to the audience in the coffee shop. And I created a two voice. Needless to say,
they renade on their right, they wouldn't have done it anyway. I think that's actually about it. You've got pretty much everything here. All the hints, tips, advice and other things that I've got to offer are all here for you. Not much that I can really say other than be prepared for your first few books to just go nowhere. I mean, you've got to reach a certain standard these days before you can go out there. It's pretty much one of the nasty byproducts, if you like, of so many people basically have created bad books, thrown them out there, and are self-published with Amazon, and the net result is people have started to turn off self-published books. It's a lot harder. So, you know, a lot of competitions, a lot of writing competitions won't accept self-published material. You've got to be with a publisher, and some competitions have even made it that the entry has to come from the publisher. So even as an author who's with a publisher, albeit a one-man band, I can't enter my own works into some of these competitions. The publisher's got to do it. You know, so good luck with that. And I've talked with other authors who have won some of these competitions that are not small competitions, you know. And still, it's done absolutely nothing for sales. It's done nothing for the feedback, nothing for the motivation to keep writing. Honestly, at the moment, I think the main drive to do writing like this is for yourself. You can expect a very rough world out there. I mean, there are some authors who are so nasty that they will leave negative reviews, one-star reviews, on the site of authors for other books that they see as being competition to theirs. You know, there are some really screwball characters out there, and you've got to have a thick skin to handle all that. There's not really much more I can say. It really is a dog-eat-dog world out there, and you've got to be prepared to work at this and grow, basically. Practice and grow. I've met some good people as a result of doing this. Had some good chats with some, I wouldn't call them fans, because, you know, I don't really have a fan base, but there are some people who have liked my writing, and we've talked about it, you know, and I've had some great conversations and made contact with some brilliant people. And at the core of all that, I think honesty has been at that core, you know. Respect and trust, as I've said before, are pretty much the currency of the internet these days. So I hope that's answered a good chunk of questions, and if you've got any more, hit me up in the comments and I'll try my best to answer them. So, bye for now.